As mentioned in the video about legal frameworks, it is sometimes possible to file a complaint or bring a claim with an international treaty body, an international court, or another institution on the basis of a human rights violation. However, it is important to realize that international law can only be engaged if the government has failed to protect your human rights. There are basically two angles to bringing a human rights claim. One is if the government itself has violated your rights, so a government representative or a government institution has violated a human right. And the second situation is one in which another individual has violated your human rights and the government subsequently has failed to protect it. In a very practical way, that means that if you, for example, brought a claim against another individual for having violated your rights, and subsequently the courts, which are in fact government instruments, have failed to protect you in that context, you can escalate the matter to the international level. When it comes to online harassment, there are a number of different human rights on the basis of which you could pursue a claim. First, there is the right to privacy, which historically has been referred to as the right to be left alone, and it usually protects an individual's personal life from unjustified intrusions. The right is aimed at protecting your physical and psychological integrity. So when there are unwarranted attacks that can result in physical or psychological harm, it is likely that it's possible to bring a complaint under a violation of the right to privacy. Second is the right to freedom of opinion and expression. Online harassment and abuse are often intended and often have the effect of silencing, censoring, or inhibiting a journalist from freely expressing themselves, or basically from doing their job. There's also an obligation for governments to create an enabling environment for journalists that allows everyone to express their opinions and take place in debate of matters of public interest. It is very rare that free speech claims are used as a means to challenge online harassment, but this is actually quite strange, and it would be good to see more jurisprudence developed on this front. Both the right to privacy and the right to freedom of expression are qualified. This means that they are not limitless, and that there can be situations in which the state can justify having violated those rights or having failed to protect them. A third ground is the right to freedom from inhuman or degrading treatment. For this right to be enforceable in the context of harassment, the harassment has to result in sufficiently serious and severe feelings of fear and helplessness. Treatment will be inhuman when it's applied for hours at a stretch and when it has caused either actual bodily injury or intense physical and mental suffering. And treatment that is degrading can be considered as such when it has aroused in its victims feelings of fear, anguish, and inferiority that's capable of humiliating and debasing them. And it's a state's responsibility to adopt measures to ensure that individuals can protect themselves against this kind of treatment, and generally that they are not subjected to it in the first place. That is an absolute right. That means that there is no grounds that a state can bring to justify having failed to protect you against this. And finally, there is the right to an effective remedy. It is the responsibility of the state to ensure that individuals whose rights have been violated can raise a complaint, that their complaint can be decided on, and that relief can be provided to them. Identifying whether you have a human rights claim that you can pursue is not as easy as it may sometimes seem. Therefore, it's important to always get legal advice, and we'll talk about that in one of the other videos. One of the things that's crucial there is that in order to be able to bring a successful human rights claim, you need to show that you've been impaired in exercising that right in a significant way. And this is where documentation and a collection of evidence comes into play. It is important to make sure that you document all the instances of harassment that you've suffered. So if it concerns direct messages, make sure to save them. If there are also messages about you, so not messages that are directly aimed at you, towards you, and sent to you, but perhaps messages that have been made in online fora or statements that others have made about you, it's also important to document those. In the online context, it's particularly important to make sure that you do this in an expeditious manner, because they might be deleted later on, in which case the evidence will be a lot trickier to provide. In the case of physical injuries, it's important to make sure that you document those as well. At least note the date, time, and how the injury occurred, but also try to get either medical evidence or, at the very least, get photographic evidence of any injuries that you sustained. It is also important to consider documenting how the harassment has impacted you being able to do your work. Have you had to call in sick for a period of time? Were you unable to do your work? That is important to keep a record of as well. And finally, because, as we said, it's only possible to bring a claim if you can demonstrate that the state has failed to protect you and your exercise of your rights, it's important to also document the instances in which you've engaged with government bodies. So, have you filed police reports? Have you filed other complaints with government bodies? It's important to keep a paper trail of that so that you can build a good dossier and consider bringing a claim.